readiness in where governments are concerned and also communities are concerned with regards to the aging process of the population at large, which is basically a concern with a lot of industry players, not only within the medical fraternity, but also within the commercial sector as well, with people now having concerns about living facilities for the aging, also having support mechanisms for the aging as well, and how would actually society be able to cope with a very productive population at this point of time, but moving forward into the next 25 or 30 years when these people are going to be needing care, how is this independence going to now translate into a dependence, into a system which can actually still sustain some sort of independence in terms of their living standards. So I think that's going to be the challenge into this next 20 or 30 years that we see, are going to be something that we have to really, really start figuring out from now. We've missed the boat with the current generation of the aging population in the world. A lot of countries are not ready to even now look after their aging population. And we see a very sporadic kind of effort done, initiatives done within communities, probably governments, in smaller countries, or even if they're big countries, they're facing very independent efforts in terms of looking after the aging community, which gives you a very imbalanced or unbalanced kind of a scenario where the aging population is concerned. So I think from a provider's perspective, we do have a responsibility into looking into the continuum of care beyond the acute care phase where hospitals have been built to look after only the curative aspect of healthcare. Now it's time for us to look into how we can now move or transcend into supportive, palliative, also preventive, so that for the next generation that's going into the aging phase, we would be more ready and be able to provide probably a more optimal kind of a system for us to support the kind of life.
How proactive is the government in UAE facilitating the issues towards aging? And what sort of incentives are they providing at
this
point of time?
I think essentially the UAE is driven with an insurance system. And through the years that they've been developing the healthcare system in the country, they have evolved a system where everyone in the UAE is now insured for healthcare progressively over the last 15 years or so. That actually gives you a very a sense of security among the population in the country, that they've been looked after financially in some sense because they're able to be supported by an insurance system essentially borne by the government. For the expatriates, of course, they are looked after by the employers. Now, illustrating the risk factors that they have within the Middle East itself, the Middle East has one of the highest numbers of risk factors when it comes to diabetes and cardiovascular diseases, also cancer, and lifestyle habits like smoking and etc. So, in terms of readiness, we see an evolution in terms of how healthcare is being approached today, going into a more preventive kind of a measure, where there are compulsory screenings that are required now for every citizen who's above 18 and who, before he reaches the age of 65, they go through a cyclical or a regular kind of a screening process every 2 years or so for the risk factors to be actually ascertained. So this profiling is actually going to be able to help countries and governments to actually plan in terms of having a very secure database into how their aging population is moving, in terms of what premorbidities they have, and also whether they will actually be needing something extra in terms of how they'll be looked after when they reach the age of dependence, so to say.
Well, thank you, Dr. Dishad, for your time.
Yes.